Thank you. It's a seven-movement orchestral suite written between 1914 and 1916. Wait, are there nine planets? Well, yes, but he didn't include Earth. And we didn't know about Pluto at the time, and I guess we're still not sure about Pluto now. But in any case, there are seven movements. Maybe he should have called it the other planets. Each movement of the suite is named after a planet in the solar system, and its corresponding astrological character as defined by Holst, not astronomical, but astrology. There were professional musicians in the previous three generations of Holst's family, and it was clear from his early years that he would follow in the same calling. He hoped to become a pianist, but was prevented by neuritis in his right arm. I think I have the same thing because I can't play the piano either. Must be it. Despite his father's career as a composer, the Royal College of Music, Holst found it, and here's a shocker, he was unable to support himself with his compositions. I find it ironic that he couldn't make it as a composer. He had a backup job, you know, like the parents always tell you, have a backup idea. His backup job was as a trombone player. So Daryl said he wanted more jokes. This is one of my favorite banjos. Two guys walk into a bar. One was a professional trombone player. The other one didn't have any money either. We have in our band, Dan is a professional trombone player. I don't want to know how much you make. It's at least 25 times your previous salary, right?
Yeah.
And just to be clear, Dan, you realize that you're playing here with us today for free, right? job to start more water, that's. The entire sweep of the planets is popular, but the first one, Mars, is my favorite. It's titled Mars, the Bringer of War. The unusual 5-4 time in this speech makes, you'll see, what makes the whole thing seem more ominous. I always think of Mars as something's coming and it's not going to be good. Circle of composers who met in St. Petersburg, Russia, from about 1856 to around 1870. Nina Yelakarev, Cesar Kuip, Modis Mussorgsky, Nikolai Rimsky-Korsakov, and Alexander Borodin. The group specifically had the idea of producing a specifically Russian kind of art music, not one that imitated the older European music or relied on European-style conservatory training. Many of Mussorgsky's works were inspired by Russian history or folklore or other nationalist themes. Tone Point, Night on Ball Mountain, and Pictures at an Exhibition. Pictures at an Exhibition is a suite in 10 movements plus a recurring and varied promenade, composed originally for piano in 1874. This is Mussorgsky's most famous piano composition and is kind of a showpiece for virtuoso pianists. It is further known through various orchestrations, especially an orchestration and arrangement done for a whole great giant orchestra by Maurice Ravel. Mussorgsky was friends with Victor Hartmann, an architect and artist, who died suddenly in 1873. An exhibit of over 400 of his works was organized in February and March of 1874. Mussorgsky lent some paintings from his own personal collection to the exhibit and viewed the show in person. He was fired by the experience and composed Pictures at an Exhibition in 6 weeks. The music depicts an imaginary tour of the art collection. Titles of individual movements allude to works by Hartmann. The movements are linked by a varying promenade, which suggests the viewer's progress through the exhibit. The theme grows, this grows from a linking device until finally becomes the integral element of the final movement called the Great Gate of Kiev. We're not going to do the whole suite, just the promenade, a movement called the Hut of Baba Yaga, and then the Great Gate of Kiev. This is another one, this is another piece, it's one of my all-time favorites.
Thank you.
Aram Khachaturian is considered one of the leading Soviet composers, best known for his ballet music, Gagan, written in 1942, and Spartacus in 1954. The Saber Dance, by far his most popular piece, is from Gagan. The Saber Dance is a movement in the final act of the ballet where the dancers display their skill with the sabers. Khachaturian himself apparently felt that the popularity of this piece, quote, deflected attention from his other works, which it does because nobody else ever plays anything else that he wrote. Saber Dance is one of the signature pieces of 20th century popular music. It was popular as played traditionally by orchestras, as chamber groups, as popularized in covers by pop artists as early as 1948. And all over the world. It's been used in a ton of films and TV shows over the decades. That has significantly contributed to its renown. If you think about it, you can remember it's used by lots of figure skaters in their performances. It has been described as one of the catchiest and most familiar, perhaps most maddening tunes to come out of the 20th century. And actually, even if it's not one of your favorites, you can't get it out of your head. It's one of my favorites, yeah. And Daryl, you know, I get to sit in front of the clarinet section a lot. I love the sounds of clarinets, unless of course you can get a couple of cats caught in vacuum. I'm just saying.
Thank you.
Excerpts from the Firebird, Igor Stravinsky. Stravinsky was a Russian composer, pianist, and conductor. Later became a French and then American citizen. He is considered one of the most important and influential composers of the 20th century and is a pivotal figure in modernist music. Stravinsky's father, Theodore, was a principal bass at the Imperial Opera in St. Petersburg. Theodore's association with many of the leading figures in Russian music, including Rimsky-Korsakov, Gordon, and Mussorgsky, meant that Igor grew up in an intensely musical home. The Firebird is based on a Russian fairy tale of the Firebird, which brings both a blessing and a curse to its owners. It was written for the 1910 Paris season of Sergei Diaghilev's Ballets Russes company. When first performed at the Opera de Paris on 25 June 1910, the work was an instant success. Critics praised the ballet for its integration of decor, choreography, and music. Some of Stravinsky's fellow musicians Sergei Rachmaninoff said that he's a great guy. What a work of genius this is. Claude Debussy, and what we would describe as a more sober reaction, he responded, "What do you expect? You have to start somewhere." Later, he became a fan. This ballet has historic significance, not only as Stravinsky's breakthrough piece, but also as the beginning of a collaboration between Diaghilev and Stravinsky. They produced two more ballets, the Petrushka in 1911, and the Rite of Spring in 1913. The Rite of Spring, the influence of the Rite of Spring cannot be overestimated. It transformed the way in which subsequent composers thought about rhythmic structure and largely responsible for Stravinsky's enduring reputation as a revolutionary who pushed the boundaries of musical design. Okay, Daryl, the Firebird was not initially one of my favorites. But after we play it here a few times, I have to, I'm like Debussy, it does grow up. Okay?
Thank you.
Carmina Burana by Carl Orff. Carmina Burana was composed in 1935 and 1936 based on 24 poems from a medieval collection and also entitled Carmina Burana. The full title in Latin includes the words secular songs for singers and choruses to be sung together with instruments and magical images. This is structured in five major sections, 25 movements in all. The most famous is titled O Fortuna, which is a theme that both opens and closes the suite. O Fortuna is basically a complaint about fortune, the inexorable fate that rules both gods and mortals in Roman and Greek mythology. Shortly after the premiere of this work, Orff said to his publisher, "Everything I have written to date, and which you have unfortunately printed, can be destroyed. With Carmina Burana, my collected works begin." His wish was fulfilled in the sense that he is known today mostly for this single work. You don't think of Carl Orff a lot, but he also was very active and very influential as a music educator. He subscribed to a dramatic concept called the Theatrum Mundi, in which music, movement, and speech are inseparable. He subtitled Carmina Burana a scenic cantata, and his intention was to stage the work with dance, choreography, visual design, and other stage actions. The piece is now largely performed just in concert halls simply as a cantata, but you should imagine a very large choir behind us accompanying the music, okay? There's originally calls for two large choirs. As I said, there are 25 movements. The whole thing takes a little over an hour. To keep it short, we're only going to play 24 movements. I'm sorry, excuse me, I misunderstood. We're going to omit 24 movements. Is that better? Okay. Does everybody know which one we're going to do? Okay. Oh, for two. Okay, we're going to do that. Carol, is Orff one of your favorites?
Yes.
Have you ever heard of Carl Orff?
Yes, I have.
makes you wish Carl had gotten around to writing something else. Before this last piece, let me appeal to you, as I often do at these concerts. This band is made up of your friends, your neighbors, your relatives. Some of us are young and some of them are old. Retirees, business people, students. We do this for fun. I always like to say we do this because music must be performed. And we do it to learn something. Any collaborative art requires a commitment to discipline and teamwork, just like any athletic team or any business project. These lessons are never completely over and done with, but practiced and expanded upon for as long as you participate. So we invite you to join us. We need some help. Have some fun. Learn something. Become a better person. We accommodate musicians with a very wide range of abilities, from near beginner to professional. Anyone can contribute and learn. Get your old horn out of the closet. Go buy or rent a new horn. Call Gail at Lindmore at NMJC, and like our former conductor, Dr. Wong, used to say, play something. Just play something. This last one, Jacques Offenbach, the can-can. Actually, the can-can is a high-energy, physically demanding dance that became a popular music hall dance in the 1840s. It continues popularity in French cabaret culture to this day. Originally danced by couples, it's now traditionally associated with a chorus line of female dancers. The main features of the dance are vigorous manipulation of skirts, petticoats, along with high kicks, splits, and cartwheels. I ran across this story at early editions of the Oxford Companion to Music. You find the can-can is quite a boisterous and laterally indecorous dance of the quadrille order, exploited in Paris for the benefit of such British and American tourists who will pay well to be well shocked. Its exact nature is unknown to anyone connected with this companion. Many composers have written music for the can-can as a dance. Most famous is today's piece, Offenbach's Gallop Infernal from the operetta Orpheus in the Underworld. Cafeteria's Sabre Dance has been associated with the can-can. And the best one I ran across is the music hall standard, Ta-ra-ra-hoo-dee. Ta-ra-ra-hoo-dee. Y'all know that? And you recognize Ta-ra-ra-hoo-dee. It's Howdy Doody time. Ta-ra-ra-hoo-dee is the theme to Howdy Doody. How cool is that? This one's going to be one of my favorites.
This is our encore. I'm always kind of complaining that, well, since I became a director, I don't get to play. So James said, why don't you just play the last one then? So I'll be playing the third one. But thank you, Don. It's so great to have you. And I got to thank Daryl, too. Daryl actually picked all this good music. It's some of my favorite stuff, too. Thank you so much. It's been the funnest concert I've ever done yet. And then our next one will be April 24th. We'll be doing some fun stuff for Motown. So you guys, please, we'll be back in this area right here for that one as well. So thank you so much. I appreciate it.
You're trying to have a percussion, it's all right. But for this piece, you're only going to play one drum. Just one. Okay, you're just kind of getting back into the story. Okay. Just one.
One, two, thank you.
Thank you.